Ho ho ho! And Merry Christmas and welcome to our subscription video. I'm wearing my Christmas gift from YouTuber James Hoffman. Thank you, James, for sending this to me.
YouTuber.
That's his official title from now on, ever. Since we're celebrating Christmas, we're also celebrating two beautiful coffees from Jaime and Enciso.
Yeah.
That's two coffees that you sourced. You've been to visit them.
Well, it's been a while since I visited them, unfortunately. Hopefully soon, 2022. Fingers crossed.
Gonna be a better year,
yeah,
2022.
Exactly. Yeah. But there are two great coffees and a relationship we've been developing for many years.
Jaime is in Huila and Enciso is in Tolima.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah. They are very close and very similar because it's basically the same varieties they grow and similar altitudes and similar climate, but just so very different. In Colombia, and especially the coffees that we source from Colombia, they prize Catura, and we of course love that coffee. It's a great coffee both for yield, the plant itself is great for that environment compared to, for example, Tipica, which they also grow or try to grow.
And there's been a lot of controversy in Colombia because the Federation of Colombian Coffee Producers released a variety, or actually a series of varieties.
One of the most prevalent is, of course, Castillo.
The Castillo was brought out to farmers, and farmers were told by the FNC, as it's called, the Federation, to plant this or these varieties. I think there are like 7 or 8 Castillo varieties. A lot of farmers and a lot of coppers and buyers don't think the Castillo tastes as good as some of the more traditional varieties.
Yeah. But both these farms have replanted all their Castillo trees. Jaime and on their farm, they have resold there with geishas instead.
This is probably a good idea.
Yeah.
At least it's a very tasty coffee.
It's a very tasty coffee, yeah. A tasty idea, you could say.
But actually, speaking of taste, let's have a taste. I'll pour the Jaime here.
Yeah. So Jaime Casillas Senior.
Don Jaime.
Don Jaime, yeah. He lives on this farm with his wife Olympia and their son Jaime Casillas Junior. He's also the chairman of the association called Desarrollo, which we also buy from. Exactly,
yeah.
And it's actually where we started buying from, where we found these farmers in Huila.
He's super passionate. It's nice to meet such a young guy who's so passionate about producing coffee. And his whole family, basically, they're very proud about the coffee they produce.
Yeah, they should be.
They should be tasting it. It's like, what really strikes me is how remarkably sweet it is. It's like syrupy to drink right now. And this was roasted yesterday, so it's very, very, very fresh still. I actually prefer it when it has degassed a little bit, because you still have here a little bit of that fresh roast flavor, the gassiness.
Yeah.
But it's so sweet.
It is, and I think it derives from the fact that the farms, especially in Huila, are very small. They pretty much maintain and do everything themselves. The people who are in the end who's selling the product, you could say, the farmers themselves, also the ones picking for the most part. They also do hire pickers in peak season, but a lot of it is done by themselves.
Yeah, and when they hire a picker, they're there themselves monitoring the picking and instructing and knowing that the better the ripeness is, the more they take care of that, the higher sweetness we'll get, the higher money we'll be able to pay for the coffee
exactly.
as well. The processing, I think, was one of the things that really astonished me when I went to visit Jaime, his meticulousness, but also his drive to experiment with the fermentation and figuring out what should he do at different times.
Yeah.
Should he take the fresh picked cherries in and just let them rest a little bit before depulping, or should he depulp straight away? How should the washing process be? How much water should he use? What about his drying? Because I remember he had like really amazing drying sheds.
Yeah.
What does he do there?
He's really proud of it. And I think one of the advantages they have is that they're located in the bottom of a valley. So they do have quite a lot of flat ground they can work on. So they built very large drying houses. And that's, of course, one of the bottlenecks in coffee production, because that's kind of where it takes the longest. So while other coffees ripen and they're quick to ferment, maybe 48 hours, and they need drying space. So what they do, and what all the Huila farmers do, is that they have raised beds underneath their patio, so it's shaded. So for the first period of time where the cherries are really wet, they stay under there. So it's a very slow process of kind of drying slowly. And then they move into the patios, which are kind of with these wind tunnels that make sure that they keep the temperature down. And then they dry for in between 20 and 30 days. So it's a very kind of long, meticulous process.
As it's cooling down, it's also opening up a lot. I find it to be like super delicate. Like what hit me when it was warm was the sweetness and the pleasant mouthfeel.
Yeah.
And as it cools down, you get more acidity coming out. You get it like just more delicate kind of feeling. Yeah. Like it's a little more light and beautiful. So Enciso. Honestly, my first thought was like, oh, it's like a natural wine. Compared to Jaime, that's super clean and delicate and elegant. Here, it's more wild. There's more stuff going on. It's definitely still completely clean. It's nothing like a natural or like that kind of fruity. It's just that there's a little more, it's a little more playful things going on on the tongue.
These two farms actually process almost the same way. They dry in the same way. They pick in the same way. Of course, going by the same kind of standards, the same quality standards. But they just vary so much. So it's very interesting.
Yeah, and I think it's a great example of terroir. Even though the distance might seem small when you look at a map of Colombia, it's like 3 times the longest distance we can drive in Denmark.
Yeah.
So it does mean that, yeah, things are just different, and that leaves that footprint or that imprint on the taste of the coffee in the end, which is fascinating.
With the Enciso family, and it's very important that it is a family, it's a mother and a father and a son that runs it. It's actually 3 family farms combined. So they have around 15, 16 hectares.
Wow, okay.
And then they have 3 kind of separate lots. So there's actually 2 peaks.
Yeah.
That has their own little mountains, which is similar to Jaime Casillas, where the father has one and the son has the other. And then there's what they call the island, which is in the middle with streams all the way around. That's the mother that runs that.
The mother, I remember, did she win Cup of Excellence or place high in Cup of Excellence one year? Or?
So they do all the kind of the post-harvest processing collectively.
Yeah.
And they also run the farms collectively.
Yeah.
But they do, when they send in, for example, for the Cup of Excellence, they do that separately. So they have their own like little award kind of race, and her name is Edith, and you can definitely tell that her husband Wilson is not as competitive as she is. she was very adamant that it was her prize, so
that's awesome.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Well, well done to all of them, I would say.
Yeah,
it's a beautiful coffee, very complex. I think the two fun coffees to taste side by side, to have that like ultra clean, sweet, delicate, and then have that little bit more wild, fruity. Still, compared to a lot of other coffees, still very clean and balanced.
Exactly.
Thank you a lot for joining me today.
Well, thank you for having me.
Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time for 2 new exciting coffees.